So I'm going to go ahead and try something a little bit different this time. Instead of a PowerPoint presentation, I'm going to be using a document camera to make the video. And this series of lectures, we're going to talk about the idea of externalities. So remember, before, we looked at the gains from trade are going to be the customer's willingness to pay, or the buyer's willingness to pay, minus the seller cost. And we looked at the market equilibrium with our demand and supply curve, and our equilibrium price, and our equilibrium quantity. And we said this quantity here and this price are going to lead to the efficient outcome, where we've maximized the gains from trade, because all the transactions over here have willingness to pay above the seller cost, because the willingness to pay is from the height of the demand curve, seller cost is from the height of the supply curve. So all these trades over here are gains creating, or wealth creating. And then all these trades over here have seller cost greater than willingness to pay. So all of those trades over there would be destructive. So they destroy value, because we're creating something that someone values less than the cost to create it. So again, that's why the market equilibrium was efficient. But now we're going to look at a situation where there are going to be effects on third parties. So externalities talk about effects on third parties, because the seller cost here is the private seller cost. It's the cost that the seller incurs, sometimes also called the internal seller cost. And the willingness to pay here reflected the benefits that the consumer got from the transaction. So the benefits were internal to the buyer or internal to the consumer. But what if there are important effects on third parties? And in particular, we can think about there might be beneficial external effects on third parties, what we call positive externalities, or there might be harmful effects on third parties, what we call a negative externality. So, in those cases, what's the situation going to look like? Well, if we have a situation of beneficial externalities or positive externalities, then the total or social benefits to a transaction equals the private or internal willingness to pay for the actual buyer or consumer, plus the external benefit. And sometimes when we want to write this as an equation, we're going to say something like, we want to think about this often in what we call marginal terms, incremental terms. So this would be the total benefits of all the consumption equals the private benefits of all the consumption plus the external benefits of all the consumption. We often want to look at the marginal social benefit. So what is the benefit of consuming one more of the product or having one more produced? That would be the marginal private willingness to pay. That's the same thing as we've been talking about all throughout the course, plus the marginal external benefit. And because I'm lazy and I want to avoid giving myself carpal tunnel here, marginal social benefit equals marginal private benefit plus marginal external benefit. So that's the happy case where we have beneficial externalities. What if we have harmful or negative externalities? Then in this case, the total or social costs are equal to the private seller costs plus the external costs on third parties. And again, we can think of a marginal version of this. So we can think about the marginal social cost is going to be equal to the marginal seller cost or private cost plus the marginal external cost. Now, what qualifies as an externality? And here, sometimes things get a bit murky because lots of transactions have effects on third parties. And we can broadly throw them into three categories out there. The first category would be what we call a technical or direct externality. And a technical or direct externality affects the production function of another firm, or if we sort of really dug into how economists look at this in a more advanced treatment of it, affects what we call the household production function of a household. And let me talk about each of these in a second after I finish my writing. So an idea would be something like this. Suppose we have a farm or a ranch or something like that, and they're putting out some fertilizer or there's runoff from the manure or something like that. And that gets into the local rivers and creeks and so on and so forth. And if it's bad for fish, and it makes it harder for fishermen to catch the same amount of fish because they have to cruise around in their boat for longer or something like that, then the activities of the ranch or farm are directly lowering the productivity of another firm, the fishermen, or something like that. So that would be an example of a negative direct externality. Or it might be that the fertilizer or manure gets into the water. And so consequently, if you swim in the river, you either have to take, you know, large precautions or it becomes more dangerous or something. And you can see how there's sort of a directly measurable effect on households' welfare. So there's a, you know, health effect there. So that is one type of externality. Another type of externality is what we call a fiscal externality. So let's suppose we have a situation where some people are deciding to smoke or continue to smoke, and those people have higher health care costs than other people. And either through a private insurance company or through a government insurance plan, they raise costs for the insurer. Well, in that case, their smoking caused an external effect, it raised costs for other people. But realize fiscal externalities are given the existing structure of economic institutions, so insurance, taxes, etc., 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 out there, there is an externality. But obviously, those economic institutions are man-made, and it's not sort of a clear case of like an absolute physical effect here like it is in these top ones. So the economic institutions are themselves malleable, and in a way, it's kind of the fault of the existing economic institutions that have created these fiscal externalities. And then it's only because we have those economic institutions that we're going to see the externality. If everyone was totally responsible for their own healthcare costs, then the smokers would themselves bear all of the costs of their smoking, and there would be no externality. A psychic externality is a situation where there's a direct effect on someone else's happiness. Or, as an economist would say, a direct effect on someone else's utility function. Utility function. So the idea here would be, when you dress in a certain way or consume a particular product, it just makes me either happy or unhappy. And the tricky thing here is that may very well be, something that actually happens, but obviously there's a measurement problem here. So that's one issue here. How do we actually measure how much your dressing in a particular way either increases or decreases my happiness? The other thing here is that if we sort of start thinking about social policy and how we would react to it, essentially we're going to allow social policy to be determined by people's preferences about other people's behavior and consumption. And so this sometimes presents what's called the meddlesome preferences problem. May or may not be a problem, but essentially we're saying that we're going to take into account the fact that maybe you're unhappy when you see people holding hands who are of different races or the same sexes or something like that. Another thing that's going to go ahead and happen here is, because of this measurement problem, we're going to have some way, if we want to deal with this problem, of thinking about interpersonal comparisons of happiness. And it may be that, say, for instance, it makes me very happy to wear short shorts out there, or my Speedo on the beach, and it may be that you're made very unhappy by seeing me wear my Speedo on the beach. And then how do we get into a question of whether I get more happiness out of wearing the Speedo or whether or not you get more unhappiness out of seeing me wear my Speedo? And are we going to go ahead and just ask people to rate that? And essentially what would happen then is we would presumably abandon decision-making to whoever yells the loudest or whines the hardest. So you can see how economists are going to be pretty reluctant to take these into account. I'm not saying they're not real, but it's very difficult to know what to do about them. Another category of externalities are what we call pecuniary or indirect externalities. And these are externalities that go through the effect on prices. So what do I mean here? So let's suppose that we have at first a monopoly pizza restaurant in a small town, and then a second pizza restaurant starts up in that town. Now that's going to affect the first restaurant negatively. It goes from being a monopolist to having a competitor. But it's exactly this process of competition that's going to decrease market power and lead us to a more efficient outcome. So you can see that things like competition Yes, having competition makes someone worse off, but competition is itself the creator of efficiency. Likewise, we could think about a situation where if a firm sells more products, of course, that increases the demand for its labor. But if labor markets themselves are not containing significant market inefficiencies, then we're going to go ahead and see that the effects on suppliers, just like the effects on competitors went through prices, the effects on suppliers of labor or raw material or leased space in a mall or whatever, already go through prices. And anything that goes through prices is itself going to be a source of efficiency. It's through those price signals that we cause efficiency to be realized. So these pecuniary or direct externalities are not a barrier to efficiency. And obviously I've taken the time to write that big and underline it, because a lot of times you hear people make arguments that invoke these pecuniary or indirect externalities, and then the claim is that we should have some particular policy solution. But again, pecuniary or indirect externalities are exactly how we get efficiency. Okay, and I'll go ahead and leave it right there.